Once upon a midnight dreary, while I pondered, weak and weary, over many a quaint and curious volume of forgotten lore, while I nodded, nearly napping, suddenly there came a tapping, as of someone gently rapping, rapping at my chamber door.
"'Tis some visitor,"
I muttered,
"rapping at my chamber door. Only this, nothing more."
I distinctly remember it was in the bleak of December, and each separate dying ember wrought its ghost upon the floor. Eagerly I wished the morrow. Vainly I had sought to borrow from my book's surcease of sorrow, sorrow for the lost Lenore, for the rare and radiant maiden whom the angels named Lenore, nameless here forevermore. And the silken, sad, uncertain rustling of each purple curtain thrilled me, filled me with fantastic terrors never felt before, so that now, to still the beating of my heart, I stood repeating,
"'Tis some late night visitor entreating entrance at my chamber door. This it is, nothing more."
Presently, my soul grew stronger, hesitating then no longer.
"Sir,"
said I,
"madam, truly your forgiveness I implore, but the fact is I was napping when so gently you came rapping, tapping at my chamber door, that I was scarce as sure I heard you."
Here I opened wide the door. Darkness there, and nothing more. Deep into the darkness peering, long I stood there wondering, fearing, doubting, dreaming dreams no mortal ever dared dream before. But the silence was unbroken, and the darkness gave no token, and the only word there spoken was the whispered word,
"Lenore."
This I whispered, and an echo murmured back the word, "Lenore." Merely this and nothing more. Back into the chamber turning, all my soul within me burning, soon again I heard a tapping, somewhat louder than before.
"Surely,"
said I,
"surely that is something at my window latest. Let me see what third it is, and this mystery explore. Let my heart be still a moment, and this mystery explore. 'Tis the wind and nothing more."
Open here I flung the shutter, when, with many a flirt and flutter, in there stepped a stately raven of the saintly days of yore. Not the least obeisance made he, not a minute stopped or stayed he, but, with mind of lord or lady, perched above my chamber door, perched upon a bust of Pallas just above my chamber door, perched and sat and nothing more. Then this ebony bird, beguiling my sad fancy into smiling, by the grave and stern decorum of the countenance it wore.
"Though thy crest be shorn and shaven, thou,"
I said,
"art sure no craven, ghastly grim and ancient raven, flying in from the night's Plutonian shore. Tell me what thy lordly name is on the night's Plutonian shore."
Quoth the raven,
"Nevermore."
Much I marveled this ungainly fowl to hear it discourse so plainly, though its answer little meaning, little relevancy bore. For we cannot help agreeing that no living human being ever yet was blessed with seeing a bird above his chamber door, bird or beast above the sculptured bust above his chamber door, with such name as Nevermore. But the raven, sitting lonely on the placid bust, spoke only that one word, as if his soul in that one word he did outpour. Nothing further than he uttered, not a feather than he fluttered, till I scarcely more than muttered,
"Other friends have flown before. On the morrow he will leave me, as my hopes have flown before."
Then the bird said,
"Nevermore."
Startled at the stillness broken by reply so aptly spoken,
"Doubtless,"
said I,
"what it utters is its only stock and stir, caught by some unhappy master whose unmerciful disaster followed fast and followed faster, so that hope he would adjure. Stern in despair instead of sweet hope it would adjure. That sad answer, never, nevermore."
But the raven, still beguiling all my sad soul into smiling, straight I wheeled a cushioned seat in front of bird and bust and door. Then upon the velvet sinking, I betook myself to linking fancy unto fancy, thinking what this ominous bird of yore, what this grim, ungainly, ghastly, gaunt, and ominous bird of yore meant in croaking nevermore. This I sat engaged in guessing, but no syllable expressing to the fowl whose fiery eyes now burned into my bosom's core. This and more I sat divining, with my head at ease reclining, on the cushion's velvet lining with the lamplight gloated o'er. But whose velvet violet lining with the lamplight gloating o'er, she shall press nevermore. Then, methought, the air grew denser, perfumed from an unseen censer swung by seraphim whose footfalls tinkled on the tufted floor.
Wretch!
I cried.
By God hath lent thee, by his angels he hath sent thee. Respite! Respite and nepenthe for the memories of this lost Lenore. Quaff! Oh, quaff this kind nepenthe, and forget this lost Lenore.
Quoth the raven.
Nevermore.
Prophet,
said I.
Thing of evil, prophet still of bird or devil, whether tempter sent or tempest tossed thee here ashore, desolate yet undaunted, on this desert land enchanted, on this home by horror haunted, tell me truly, I implore, is there balm in Gilead? Tell me truly, I implore.
Quoth the raven.
Nevermore.
Prophet,
said I.
Thing of evil, prophet still of bird or devil, by the heaven that bends above us, by the God we both adore, tell the soul with sorrow laden, if by the distant Aden, it shall clasp the Satan maiden, whom the angels name Lenore, the rare and radiant maiden, whom the angels name Lenore.
Quoth the raven.
Nevermore.
Be that word our sign of parting, bird or fiend!
I shrieked, upstarting.
Get thee back into the tempest and the night's Plutonian shore. Leave no black plume as a token of the lie thy soul has spoken. Leave my loneliness unbroken. Quit the bust above my door. Take thy beak from out thy heart and take thy form from off thy door.
Quoth the raven.
Nevermore.
And the raven, never flitting, still is sitting. Still is sitting on the pallid bust of Pallas just above my chamber door. And his eyes have all the seeming of a demon's that is dreaming. And the lamplight o'er him streaming throws his shadow on the floor. And my soul, from out that shadow that lies floating on the floor, shall be lifted nevermore.